Thank you, President Joel, Rabbi Lamb, the Chairman Crissell, Dean's Administration, Rosh Yeshiva, to the esteemed faculty, to my distinguished fellow honorees, to the Israeli delegation led by Eli Aflalo, Chairman of Kakal, and the other representatives of the Israeli government who are here with us today, to the very proud families and friends and relieved parents, Mazal Tov, to my family who was here, to my incredible wife, to the YU board members, and of course, Achron Achron Chaviv, the reason why we're assembled here today, to the remarkable Yeshiva University graduating class of 2013, Mazal Tov. Okay, now we're waking up. Thank you so much for this invitation and for this distinct honor. I think I should be sitting over there, not here. I have to admit, it's a bit daunting delivering a commencement speech. A few days before I flew out to New York, I overheard a conversation between two of my children. My eldest was explaining to his younger sibling what a great honor it was for their Abba to have been asked to deliver today's speech, and emphasized that only two types of individuals are chosen for such a task, either great academics or very famous individuals, to which a younger child responded, "Whoa, an Abba is neither." True story. Sorry, Yehuva. Since I'm certifiably neither, coupled with the fact that although I'm accustomed to speaking in front of large audiences and very distinguished personalities, it is a first for me to speak in front of the entire collective history of my personal education, my past teachers, professors, and rebbeim. Yes, as you've heard, I'm a YU alum and a proud one at that. 27 years ago, following family tradition, my wonderful parents sent me off to MTA, which was followed by Yeshiva College and Smichat Reitz, culminating with my studies at Azrieli's. As you just heard, I also had my sights additionally on attending Einstein, but Rabbi Brander instead convinced me to move to Boca Raton, Florida, which was one of the best decisions of my life, for which I would like to acknowledge his guidance and thank him publicly. Yes, I am a proud YU alum, but in all honesty, I think I only became truly aware of how much YU has had an impact on my life only years after graduation, an appreciation for the institution that continues to mature and grow as the years pass. At the time of my graduation, and I would venture that it's similar to today as it was in my father's time, there are three types of YU graduates. There are some of which I have friends who look back at their YU days with the emphasis on the yeshiva component of the Yeshiva University experience. They look back at the university curriculum as an excuse or an opportunity they had to garner parental permission to continue their focus on Torah learning, the true source of their passion. The university classes in their eyes were merely prerequisites that fill their time between Shir and Seder. On the other hand, there are graduates of which I also have friends who look back at YU with a completely opposite viewpoint. They came to YU to attend university, and university they attended. They took the necessary coursework so that they can continue onwards to the graduate schools of choice and eventually lead successful careers. The yeshiva components of their YU experience could have been easily replaced with any other educational pursuit. And sadly, their notes on Tanakh, Gemara, Torah Shebaal Peh, and Halacha eventually find a cozy nook in some storage facility. Actually, I feel that it's truly extraordinary and commendable that both types of students feel at home at YU. But before you all walk out of this ceremony, probably only 2 hours from now, diplomas in hand, and celebrate this momentous occasion, it will be a shame, and we would be remiss if we didn't highlight a third type of YU student, perhaps the very ideal vision of what the institution represents. I have no doubt that the majority of the graduates assembled before us have already recognized and internalized this lesson already years ahead of my own delayed realization. But nonetheless, I think it's important enough to mention at this special occasion. Our generation, I include myself as well as the graduates, talking to you. Sadly, we did not experience having the Rav in our midst, of witnessing firsthand a Gadol HaTorah who straddled effortlessly between a Ksos and a Kierkegaard. And it puts us at a tremendous disadvantage of grappling with the inimitable philosophy of this institution. But heroically and astonishingly, 20 years later, YU still transmits a unique and noble approach, a derech ha-chayim, a mesorah that resonates this extraordinary synergy. Now call this synergy what you wish, Yeshiva University, Torah Umada, Torah Derech Eretz, Shleimut, Shleimus. We're all so used to these terms that we often forget that it's a unique approach, a very challenging but ultimate pursuit, an ideal that actually may need to be stated and clarified from time to time and not be taken as a given tenet of the student population. So, 20 years after I wore that ridiculously unflattering robe that each of you are wearing today, I can tell you in personal retrospect what I've taken from the Yeshiva University experience and what this remarkable synergy can offer. This philosophy, this synergy, doesn't deny for a moment that Torah is all-encompassing. The synergy should not be misunderstood or reinterpreted so that the accent is placed on the last words of university or mada. As of Shimon Schwab so eloquently voiced, the philosophy stresses the Torah's conquest of life and not the Torah's flight from life. It stresses the Torah's casting a light into the darkness rather than hiding from the darkness. It means applying Torah to the earth and not divorcing it from the earth. This approach expects us to open our eyes to the world around us, propelling us as Torah Jews to impact, inspire, and affect our surroundings. It underscores that education and leadership cannot function in a vacuum, and it compels us to take our Torah values and bring it to our academic pursuits, scientific training, literary and artistic skills, to our careers and work environments. It is a belief that when we engage our surroundings, not only will the world, so desperately in need of inspiration, benefit from our actions, but we will also be enhanced by this experience. Over the last 11 years, I've been witness to some of the most extraordinarily inspiring stories. There's one which sticks out, which perhaps can help drive this point home. A few months back, I was meeting an Israeli in my office in Jerusalem regarding some small project. Throughout the meeting, the person across my desk was completely lost and preoccupied in his own thoughts. I was just about to confront him and draw him back into our discussion when he looked back at me with tears in his eyes and stated rather bluntly, "My son is an incredible human being." Before I had a chance to respond, he continued, "My son is 20 years old. He's currently serving in a special elite unit in the IDF. He spends days on end over enemy lines, camouflaged sometimes as a rock, a bush, a pile of mud, you name it. And every 3 weeks or so, he comes home for Shabbat exhausted with those beautiful blue eyes and a pile of laundry." He continued telling me that that very morning before he left his home to come to our meeting, his wife was doing the laundry and had to actually hose down their son's uniform before washing it to remove all the caked on mud. And then she discovered something remarkable in the pants pocket. There was a Gemara with a hard cover removed so that it could easily be slipped into the pants pocket and a tiny LED light holding the place of the daf. Both parents confronted their son to ask about the Gemara. The son explained that indeed during the wee hours of the night, camouflaged as a rock, or a bush, or a pile of mud, he would make sure that he maintained his steady learning schedule. He would use the tiniest of lights so that he would not, God forbid, alert the enemy's attention to his position. This is when the father started crying. Stunned parents asked how long had he kept up this practice. In response to which, the young man retrieved a couple of other mesechtot, also missing their hardcovers, with a dapim with a folio stained in mud. This exceptional soldier, although beyond the tchum, the boundaries of his Beit Midrash, and in truth actually beyond the borders of our country, was anchored and ensconced in his Dalet Amot Shel Halacha. I tell this particular story because I feel it personifies what each YU graduate here in this room knows what he or she can do, can be. Let's not exaggerate here, not all of us can be camouflage snipers who learn Daf Yomi at 2 o'clock in the morning, but YU has instilled in many of us, whether we're accountants, soldiers, doctors, therapists, even rabbis, an ideological drive, the conviction, the passion, the chpatiyut, the care and concern. We've been taught to open our eyes and see the myriad number of concerns that need to be addressed and repaired in our community and beyond, and have the fortitude and courage to embark on making those changes while all the while being grounded securely in Torah and Halacha. Once I heard from Rabbi Lam in high school the following few sentences. "This notable institution has taught us to approach the greater world by neither dismissing with contempt nor embracing without reservations, but rather by being both critical and respectful, most of all, involved and engaged." A direct consequence of this principle of engagement is YU's staunch support, love, and connectivity to Israel, and our firm belief, our resolute conviction in religious Zionism. I was definitely going to speak about Israel. Because even if you don't transcribe to the belief that the state of Israel is a manifest miracle or that the Zionist movement is a redemption promised by the prophecies, you need to be quite reasonably disengaged to not acknowledge the miraculous times we live in. Acknowledge the miraculous times we live in. Yes, I know, our generation, I speak about the graduates and myself, has perhaps a seemingly more challenging charge. While our grandparents experienced firsthand May 14th, Hey Iyar, 1948, listening to the crackling sounds over the radio of Anu Machrizim Bezot al Hakamat Medinat Yisrael, Be'eretz Yisrael, Hi Medinat Yisrael, we declare the establishment of the Jewish state in Israel, and our parents lived through the astonishing moments of 1967, and witnessed Rav Goren dancing with our soldiers at the recapture of the Kotel, and the unification of Yerushalayim, we, in our generation, don't have memories of a world without a state of Israel, nor of a state of Israel without a unified Yerushalayim. And it may be, that's our bracha, but it may be easy, so easy for us, to fall victim of the axiom of Ein Balanes Makir Beniso, that the recipient of a miracle is often unaware of the miracles bestowed upon him. So we may need to just open our eyes a bit wider and take in this sensational sight and recognize and be cognizant of the fact that the kibbutz galiot that has occurred and is occurring is miraculous. That we have our own Jewish army is nothing short of a miracle. That the development, innovation, technological advancement, economic stability are all simply miraculous. That the amount of Torah learning taking place in Israel today has not been rivaled since the times of the second Beit HaMikdash. That the fact that we can actually pass legislation in our ridiculous, interesting Knesset is beyond miraculous. These are facts, undisputable facts. We live in a time when miracles are daily headlines. Ki ayin ba'ayin yiru b'shuv Hashem Tzion, that we see and witness firsthand. Of course, I'm not that naive. Miracles are not without their own complicated realities. Sometimes they're downright messy. And by no means simple or one-dimensional, they never have been. But Israel is indeed a miracle. The only question, the only challenge that is presented to us is that while we saw the awe, the wonder, the marvel in our parents' and grandparents' eyes, we have to ask ourselves, what will we bequeath to our children and grandchildren? What is our personal connection to the state of Israel that constitutes our religious, emotional, and spiritual estate? Yes, it's natural to look back at the experiences of previous generations wistfully, to feel that significant history and significant drama is a thing of times past. However, the truth is that each generation has its own new dramas and creates its own history. The question is, what is our story? What role are we going to play in future history? What is the unique contribution that each of us can make? Over the last 11 years, Tony, Dr. Gelbart, and I have canvassed communities throughout North America, sharing our narrative and trying to inspire others to connect to Israel. And I must admit that it's been a long and often lonely journey, which makes today's honor even more emotional for the two of us, and perhaps more importantly for our families who stood by our side as we fought our Don Quixote battles against the windmills of Zionist apathy. Zionist apathy, the blindness of the Jewish community to the miracle that is modern Israel. There's a Hebrew song, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. The words actually come from a medrash cited in Yalkut Shemot, which I think perhaps best describes the times we live in. We can break out in song also, break out the Maccabees. B'shah shemelech ha-mashiach ba omer agag beit ha-mikdash. Mashiach will come and will stand on the roof of the Beit HaMikdash. You can't get a more impressive visual than that. V'umashmir lehem liYisrael, and he'll declare to Israel, saying, Anavim, 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 igiyaz man gulatchem. Humble ones, modest ones, the time for your geula, for your redemption has arrived. V'meinatem aminim, and if you don't believe, re'u ba'orish zarech aleichem, just open your eyes to the radiance that is upon you. V'meinatem aminim, Mashiach on top of the Beit HaMikdash. And if you don't believe, how can it be that a person can miss what's happening? How can one not notice the astonishing times we live in? Too many, way too many are unengaged, unaware, uninformed, unconscious of this radiance. Sadly, there are less people making Aliyah from North America annually than the number of people sitting in this arena today. Now, this is where you come in. You have the ability to stop this trend. You have the capacity to recalibrate our national compass. You have the talent, conviction, passion, ideological drive to script a future story of our people. It does not mean that you all have to live in Israel, although that would be magnificent. It means that at least you should all live Israel. Live Israel. Have your hearts, thoughts, tefillot directed to Artzeinu, our land. Support, defend, protect, and advocate for Artzeinu. Stand proud, be strong, and lead for Artzeinu, our land. And raise your children, please God, to be in awe and marvel and want to move themselves to Artzeinu. Akan, I reached my quota of pro-Israel content. There's a lot riding on all of you, and I'm so sorry for adding all this extra stressful responsibilities. As a graduate of YU of 2013, you are uniquely positioned to make a difference. You are bright, you are capable, you are educated, you are motivated, you're engaged in Jewish life, and you have, please God, your future ahead of you. As you step out of these walls, you'll be making important personal choices in the coming months and years, and that is why I give you this message of empowerment and responsibility, of engagement and Zionism on your special day. I have one quote that hangs over my desk in Yerushalayim. It's a quote from Teddy Roosevelt that states, "What we need is more people that specialize in the impossible." The tasks at hand may seem impossible, but you are all up to the challenge. The world awaits your talent and conviction. Our people need your optimism and principles, and our land requires your hope and promise. You are our future. Shimaleh Hashem et kol mishalot libchem letova v'tishre shechina b'maseh yedeichem. Mazal tov.